Well, it is really an honor to have these two gentlemen with us today. I've had the opportunity to actually talk with them on the radio recently about a number of different things related to the state's judicial system. And it turns out that both of these two gentlemen have now assumed what is termed primary responsibility for the implementation of the civics education component of Chief Justice Martin's Administration of Justice Plan. And today they're going to tell us all about that, the importance of civics education. I could read you their biographies. They are literally 2 to 3 pages long for each of these gentlemen. Suffice to say, both of them very well known, very well respected. We're going to begin today with Justice Paul Newby.
Thank you. This is my colleague, Justice Sam Ervin the IV, belovedly referred to as Jimmy. We're delighted to be here with you. So 1776, our framers of our state constitution started thinking about important principles. They put in our constitution a frequent recurrence to fundamental principles is absolutely necessary to preserve the blessings of liberty. A frequent recurrence. Jefferson emphasized that there needed to be a revolution every 20 years because people would become complacent, that people wouldn't think about the uniqueness of the American experiment. If you look at our founding and our founding fathers and their understanding of the Greek city-states and the Roman Republic before the empire, their understanding of Locke and Hobbes and Montesquieu, wrestling with this idea of, one, can people self-govern? And two, if they can, what does this look like? How do we get there? Keeping in mind of the kind of transformative spirit that was started in America, but then you've got the French Revolution, which was a disaster. You have the beginnings of what could have been a democratic movement in Russia that was quashed because of the what happened in France in the French Revolution and the tyranny there and the torture. It does make us stop and reflect, what was different about America? What about this American experiment who went against the grains of history, where history says those who have power tell people what their rights are and people either submit or die, as opposed to the Jeffersonian view, capturing the view of Americans that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all are created equal and endowed not by the government or the Constitution or the Bill of Rights, but endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights, life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. What are those concepts? What do they look like? Now, when Bob Skiver over here and I were at the U.S. Attorney's Office, I had the opportunity to get back North Carolina's original copy of the Bill of Rights, stolen in 1865 by a Union soldier. And I did the undercover sting operation in 2003 that got it back. Yes, National Treasure 3, coming to a theater near you. But because of that, I've been all over the state. My mom was a school teacher 30 years, so I kind of have that in my blood. I'm an adjunct over at Campbell. I like doing civics education. I've been to schools, high schools. I've been kindergarten through high school, colleges, university. I mean, I've been all over the state the last 12 years talking about civic education. And the most frequently asked question I get at a civic group is, oh, you're a justice on the Supreme Court. There aren't many of you, are there? I don't think I've ever met one. Can you help me with my speeding ticket? It's like, you know, if you got a speeding ticket in North Carolina Supreme Court, fire your lawyer, okay? This is not going to be a good day for you. You know, the second most frequently asked question I get is, what's it like to have a lifetime appointment? I was like, man, you know, you're not going to believe this. Recently, like 1868, our Constitution says we're going to elect judges, not appoint them. So we got to run for election. We are statewide elected people. And that causes a lot of confusion because people kind of think we're legislators in black robes. And if you've got a legislator in a black robe, don't vote for them. Vote for the opponent. You don't want that, okay? You got to understand the system of checks and balances, the idea of the legislative branch making the laws and the executive carrying them out. And the judicial branch doing two primary functions. One is to apply the law as intended by the branch that passed it, but also to protect fundamental constitutional rights that are violated. Now, I do have two of my constitutions with me today, one federal, one state. Which is older? Don't answer out loud. Don't want to embarrass you, but the state constitution, 1776, federal constitution, 1787. All right? And we didn't ratify until 1789. Anybody know why? There was no protection of fundamental rights and freedoms. North Carolina's the 12th state to ratify, and we only ratified after the Bill of Rights, like I was telling you about, that got stolen by our Union soldier, after that was passed by Congress and conveyed to the state of North Carolina. We held a second constitutional convention where we ratified. We're the only state to have decided not to ratify and actually acted on it in 1788. So this is important. Our state constitution, closest we get to a democracy, is under our state constitution, our elected House and Senate members, now they did have one-year terms, but we doubled it to two-year terms. Many people felt that a one-year term was stretching the limitation of human weakness, that power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely, and a one-year term was too long. Needless to say, the two-year term that we adopted in 1835 was hotly contested. Nonetheless, under the state constitution, the legislature acts for us, we the people, and the only time that we can say someone or the state legislature has gone beyond its power, it has to be beyond a reasonable doubt, limited by this document. Okay, the federal constitution, on the other hand, is a limited grant of power, and Madison actually argued we don't need a Bill of Rights because the federal power being limited, keeping in mind federal court, first question is, how do we even have jurisdiction to hear this? It's got to be under the federal constitution. So Madison argued we don't need a Bill of Rights because the federal government will never be strong enough to encroach upon fundamental rights and freedoms anyway. And y'all laugh and we voted no. So these are some basic ideas, and yet my belief is most of North Carolinians, most of us Americans, again, we take for granted these fundamental rights and freedoms, and our knowledge of, now not y'all, because y'all are here frequently and you get good education, but most North Carolinians, most Americans, their knowledge is kind of like Barney's right here. Everything you ever want to know about North Carolina, well, you learned on the Andy Griffith Show.
All right, go ahead.
Constitution of the United States.
Just give me the first word and then I'll know the rest.
Okay, we.
We.
We?
We.
Are you sure?
I'm looking right at it.
Oh, we.
We!
The.
We the. We the.
People.
We the people. We the people. We the people. We the people.
Of
we the people of
the United.
We the people of the United flag. Breathe. Win. Way. Star.
States.
We the people of the United States.
In order. To form a more perfect.
Perfect.
You.
To form a more perfect you.
Union.
Union. In order to form a more perfect union.
S. Ta.
Ta.
Fle.
Fle.
Shh.
Establish.
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 Just.
Establish just.
Tis.
Justice. Establish justice.
Ensure domestic tranquility. Provide for the
common defense.
Promote the general welfare. and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity to ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America.
You want to run through that again, or do you think you got it?
I got it. You learn something, you learn it.
And I'm not sure whether Justice Newby always has me come up right after this video because he thinks Don Knotts and I look alike or what. But it's also a privilege for me to be here today. I appreciate the level of interest that you're showing in the things that we're doing on. Justice Newby and I both have a real deep and lasting interest in this subject. Like him, I have done everything I could to try to facilitate civics education around the state as well. Like him, my mother was a high school social studies teacher for close to 20 years after she got my youngest sibling out of the house and went back to what we would call in Burke County public employment. And so this is something that's really very near and dear to me as well. As Donna indicated in her introduction, the reason that we're doing this is because Chief Justice Martin, about 2 years ago, promulgated an administration of justice plan that had a number of components to it, one of which was to increase the level of civics education generally and specifically education with respect to the role that the judiciary plays. We had a retreat, and before you get excited about what that amounted to, it consisted of walking two blocks to the state bar building and sitting in a conference room that had one window for like 9 hours. And so it was a real junket, believe me. And he asked various members of the court to be involved in different aspects of the implementation of his administration of justice program, and Justice Newby and I volunteered to try to be primarily responsible for this portion of his plan, the portion that talks about the importance of civics education and that tries to do what can be done within the limits of the time that we have to facilitate the improvement of civics education around the state. Now, what does that mean in practice? At this point, about a year into the effort, we really have two prongs to it. I know some material has been passed out around the group, and I urge you to look at it when you get a chance. But there are really two things that we're doing in an effort to try to make this goal a reality. The first, and this is being run primarily by Justice Newby and me, is the development of a Speakers Bureau. We now have available about 300 people statewide who have agreed to go and speak to school classes, civics groups, church groups, any other type of group that you can think of about civics education issues. We've given them some materials that they can use in order to make these presentations. The folks involved consist of a wide range of people. I looked at the list to see who's on it. The two of us are on it. Other members of the Supreme Court are on it. Members of the Court of Appeals are on it. Judges of the District and Superior Court are on it. Members of the bar are on it. You'd expect those kinds of people, but we also have clerks of court. We have assistant and deputy clerks of court. We have juvenile court counselors, and we have interested citizens. So it's a wide spectrum of people who have responded to this invitation to make themselves available. We have people in, I think, a little bit more than 90 of the 100 counties in the state. So we're not talking about just the large urban counties like Wake or Mecklenburg, but there are folks who have volunteered in some of the smaller rural counties as well. Some of us have agreed to go statewide to the extent that we can. I can't top Justice Newby, who I think's done a Skype program for a class in Germany. Nobody in Germany ever heard of me. So he's done that type of thing as well. I usually try to show up in person to frighten them in living color, but those opportunities are out there. We are at the very beginning of this effort, and one of the things that we're trying to do is to go around and to publicize the existence of this opportunity so that more folks can take advantage of it. The easiest way to request a speaker is to go on the CelebrateNCCourts.org website, which is in the materials that you've got there. I did get that right, didn't I? celebrate NC Court's website, there's a program, there's a place where you can request a speaker. You can also call Sharon Gladwell at the office, at the administrative office of the courts, if you prefer to do it that way, and she can work out arrangements for people to come as well. We're hoping that people will genuinely take advantage of this. You can always make this kind of opportunity available, but you can't necessarily make people take advantage of it. So as part of our effort to get people to take advantage of it, Justice Newby and I, and also Judge Linda McGee, Chief Judge Linda McGee of the Court of Appeals, who couldn't be here today because she's supposed to start hearing cases in 35 minutes and thought she probably ought to be at doing her day job instead of with us, but she expresses her regrets at not being able to be here. We've been going around trying to publicize this, the availability of the Speakers Bureau. We were on Rick and Linda's program several weeks ago. We've done some others. There have been some press coverage in the NNO and the Greensboro Record and some other smaller papers around the state. The Administrative Office of the Court has sent out a press release. There have been other attempts to publicize it, but I hope that y'all, to the extent that you have an opportunity to let people know that this exists, that you will do so, because there's nothing that will kill a project quicker than nobody taking advantage of it. People regularly, I mean, we've all had the experience of volunteering to do something and then never hearing from anybody again. And that's what I don't want to have happen with respect to this particular project. The second thing that we are doing is a broader effort across the entire court system. As has already been indicated, there are a number, coincidentally, of important anniversaries going on within the court system, the creation of the unified court system. And that doesn't sound like a big deal. But we're one of the very few states in the country that actually has a unified court system. When I've talked to older lawyers who tell me about the local courts that they used to appear in, there'd be recorders' courts, justices of the peace courts, city courts. There were in each county in the state, many cities had separate local courts from the county courts. The rules were different. The jurisdiction of each court was different. It was a real hodgepodge. And it made it very difficult for litigants and their attorneys, and frankly the judges that sat in those courts, to know what to do. So the creation of the unified court system that we have now is actually a pretty big deal, and we were one of the very few states in the 1960s that were able to muster the political will after a 10-year effort to put that together. So that's actually a very important anniversary. This is also the anniversary of the creation of the district courts, which replaced this hodgepodge of local courts. We have the 240th anniversary of the Superior Court, our oldest court, the 200th anniversary of our own court, and then the 50th anniversary of the Court of Appeals. Now, what's that involve? Each of these courts is doing a different celebratory kind of activity. It's being coordinated through this Celebrate NC Courts Committee that Chief Judge McGee chairs. And there's a lot of local involvement in different places. There have been, this year, the principal emphasis has been on the creation of the district courts. And so many districts have had forum or other types of events within individual judicial districts that talk about what I was discussing earlier, what the hodgepodge of the older courts looked like, why they were problematic, why the creation of the district courts was such a major step forward in reforming the court system in this state. We're going to move from that to the creation of the celebration of the 240th anniversary of the Superior Court, and then the appellate courts as well. In addition to the types of things that the district court judges have done, one of the things that there's a real hope that we'll be able to do with the celebrations of the anniversaries of the creation of the appellate courts is for us to get out and go to other places in the state. For the most part, the appellate courts sit in Raleigh. The Court of Appeals has greater latitude by statute than the Supreme Court does, interestingly enough. And I know there are hopes that the Court of Appeals will be able to go out and sit in many different counties in the state for the purpose of letting more folks have an opportunity to see how that court works. We're in the early stages of thinking about that ourselves. They're trying to focus on going and sitting in places where the current judges live, because there's a fairly good representation statewide of where they live or where they're from, and the hope is if they can go back in many instances to their home county and sit there, that will be beneficial. We are thinking about trying to get unlimited flexibility for the period of 2018 and 2019, 2018 being the 200th anniversary of the enactment of the legislation that created the court, and 2019 being the year in which of the 200th anniversary of the actual first sitting of the court. We're hoping that we can get authorities to sit around the state for a couple of years. That may include in some of the major urban areas that we don't sit in generally. It may also include sitting in some of the historic seats of the court. Now, why is that important? I mean, I didn't really fully appreciate why it was important until earlier this year. The court, as I said, has to sit in Raleigh unless the General Assembly authorizes it to sit somewhere else. Up until last year, we were authorized to sit in Edenton and in Raleigh. And the courts had two sessions of court in Edenton. There was a sense that we needed not only a second seat of court in eastern North Carolina, but also a seat of court in western North Carolina, which dovetailed very nicely with my own personal life because I live in Morganton. And the court had its summer sessions in Morganton from 1847 or 1848 to 1861. And so as a result of some of Justice Newby's efforts with the General Assembly, we were able to get authorization to sit in the old Burke County Courthouse, which is the actual building that the court sat in the 1840s, 1850s, and early 1860s, which was a real neat experience for me because my father, my grandfather, and my great-grandfather all practiced law in that courtroom, and it really gave me a chance to do something for real there as well. This has real civic education benefits. We got in that session of court a great deal more news coverage than we get when we sit down here. It was an opportunity for citizens who would never, ever have a chance to come watch an appellate court sit to actually do so. And we had almost a full courtroom for both of the 2 days that we were sitting there. I did television interviews. We had newspaper coverage. We had events around the community. I used it as an opportunity to go out and speak to some classes and groups in Burke County. So the mere fact that we do these kinds of things gives us a greater opportunity to get out and to see people that don't know much about the courts in general and to educate them about what the judicial branch does. I don't have as good a story as Paul. To me, people don't ask me about what they can do about their speeding tickets. I mean, he just is obviously a higher caliber of trial lawyer than I ever was. But the level of public knowledge of what the institutions of government are supposed to do, with particular emphasis upon the court system, is not high. I'm sure you've seen survey data from around the country of how many people can name their senators or their members of Congress, how many people can name the state legislators from their district, how many people can name a single member of the United States Supreme Court. Virtually nobody outside a small group of lawyers can name anybody on the North Carolina Supreme Court or Courts of Appeal. That's not good, but what's even more problematic is, regardless of whether they know our names or not, they don't know what we can and can't do and how we function, nor do they understand why what we do is important. Justice Newby started out by talking about why did the American experience differ from the French experience or the Russian experience, or to some extent from the English experience in the Cromwellian and Glorious Revolution period before that. What makes us distinct is the fact that we have a rule of law that we genuinely try to follow. We may disagree from case to case over what the law is in a particular area, but all seven of us and everybody that I've ever served on the Court of Appeals with and everybody that I served on the Utilities Commission with was dedicated to the notion that our job was to figure out what the law is and how does it apply to a particular set of facts. If I had wanted to be a legislator, I could have run for the legislature. Didn't want to. The fact that we have a group of folks who maybe, while we may not always succeed, try very hard to neutrally apply legal rules that were created through the democratic process makes us distinct. And that's the real distinction that I hope that we can celebrate through this process. So I appreciate the chance to come and be with you today. I hope I haven't anesthetized you too badly. And I think that we're happy to answer. I'm going to turn the microphone back over to my friend and colleague, Justice Newby, but we'll be happy to answer questions. And that would include any suggestions you might have as to how we can do this better.
Just stand up here and we'll just... Yes, sir.
I know when y'all were in Morganton, y'all had a lot of cases that were from the western part of the state. Is that what y'all were going to try to do also? If you can go try to schedule cases that are from that part of the state if you are able to get the authority to sit in other places?
Well, the Chief Justice establishes what the calendar is, but I know that would certainly be his preference. The idea would be, if there are local attorneys that have appealed and we've granted review of those appeals, then those would be the kinds of cases that would have the most local interest. Yeah, Corey.
Can you define what you mean by civic education?
Because
there's a lot of different ideas about it.
Absolutely. Civic education, or a frequent recurrence to fundamental principles, what it has to do is to get everyone to think about who we are as a people, what it means when Jefferson said that there are truths that are self-evident, that life, liberty, or in Locke's view, property, why pursuit of happiness instead of just property, I personally believe because he thought it was a broader term, okay? But, when you think about our founding in historical perspective, go back and read the Federalist Papers, read Democracy in America by de Tocqueville, read the writings of Washington, his farewell address, where he says the pillars of our nation are religion and morality. In his view, morality doesn't exist apart from religion. The government should encourage religion. We see a lot of discussion, or some would argue persecution, based on, is this good for us as a people? The public square, what's the nature of the public square? Should we be saying, well, if you say something that hurts somebody's feeling, let's take that out of the public square? Is that good for us? What about the First Amendment that gives us the right to say stuff, even if it's dumb or stupid or hateful? Isn't it better to have the dialogue in the public square? Do we want to constitutionalize stuff? Justice Scalia was so right when he points out that when you constitutionalize something, you take it out of the public square. You take it away from the elected officials. And what do we need to be worrying about there? These are all fundamental questions that folks need to think about.
I think, as I conceive it, it really focuses on two things. If you look at both the state and the federal constitutions, they really do two things. They have the differences that Justice Newby alluded to, with the federal constitution being a statement of what can the federal government do, as compared to the state constitution being what are the limits on otherwise available general governmental authority. But both constitutions do really two things in their current form. One is they set forth a structure of how a government is supposed to function, what is its authority or lack of authority. And people don't have much understanding of basic structural concepts such as Paul alluded to Montesquieu. People don't hear much about Montesquieu now, but I mean, the idea of separation of powers was very revolutionary at the time. It's something we still grapple with it in our day jobs. For the most part, have bicameral legislatures? What is the role of an executive? What are the limits? How do each branch of government function, and how do they check each other? And those are things that really don't seem to me to get taught as much as they should. What is the role of each branch? Why do you have multiple branches of government? What are the roles of each branch of government? What are the limits that each can place on the other? And the second, which is the one that we tend to talk about more, but it's, I don't think, any more important than the structural component. What are the basic fundamental rights that each of us have as individuals that the government cannot effect. Now, there's all kinds of arguments at the margins, but I think there's broad agreement on those things, and people don't understand. You'd be amazed at what people think their rights are or are not. And there's just, I mean, to me, if we can get both the structural concepts and some idea of what your basic rights are, we will have gone a long way to enabling people to participate in the type of society that we've got compared to where we've been. Yes, sir.
We know citizens have concerns with the, I call it, the overreach of the federal courts and legislature and such. What troubles you that the federal government is doing that is, I guess, hurting your ability to do your job?
Well, I mean, our job, I mean, I'm going to give you a non-answer, and I'm going to tell you it's a non-answer before I give it to you so you won't say he dodged my question. And at least as I understand my role, under the federal Constitution, there's a provision called the Supremacy Clause that says that federal law is supreme over state law. And, you know, and that has all kinds of, it's like everything else, you can get into legal weeds very quickly, and I don't really want to get there. But who determines federal law? And the way that federal law is determined is an interesting process. In many places you have unified systems. We have separate state and federal systems. We have the authority to make decisions as to what federal law is. However, to the extent that at least in our court, we are only bound by what the United States Supreme Court says. We can look at what the lower federal courts say and consider it, but we're not bound by it, and we're free to disregard it if we think they're wrong. But once the U.S. Supreme Court makes a decision with respect to a subject of federal law, whether we agree with it or not, we are obligated to comply with it. And so if the U.S. Supreme Court says federal power is X, I mean, I'm just going to hypothesize, even though I may think or may not think that the federal court was wrong about that, I still have to follow that because of the Supremacy Clause. So ultimately, the ultimate arbiter of the extent of federal authority is, first of all, what are Congress and is Congress willing to pass? What is the executive branch willing to do within its authority? And if someone challenges it, the ultimate determiner of whether that challenge is valid or not is the U.S. Supreme Court. And we are required to accept what they say, whether we agree with it or not. And that's not anything unusual. Even down to state law, the General Assembly may pass a law that Paul or I think they shouldn't have passed, but I can't sit there and say, oh, that's a terrible law, and therefore I'm going to do absolutely everything I can to keep it from having any effect on anybody. Or on the other hand, I can't say, this is great, I wish they'd done this 200 years ago, let's make it as broad as we can. We've got to genuinely try to figure out what did they mean and how do we best effectuate what their intent is. And it's the same with the extent of federal authority as it is with really any other law.
Certainly I agree with what Justice Ervin said. I mean, my personal view is the United States was created and is best off when there is a vibrant federalism, which means that the states are operating as places where there can be types of political experimentation, social experimentation, and we as a country are better off when that occurs. But as Justice Ervin pointed out, we ultimately are bound by the U.S. Supreme Court in their interpretation of federal law. Mr. Skiver. I'm going to let Justice Ervin talk about that because he's been working with June Atkinson. But thank you for what you do. I know you go in the schools and you've got a curriculum that you've developed to help people think about fundamental principles, particularly high school kids, middle school kids. So thank you for doing that.
There's actually there. I looked a couple of weeks ago at that very statute. There are really two things in the statute that governs what the curriculum has to contain. First of all, there are requirements that, government or civics be taught at certain grade levels in the same statutory subsection that talks about the requirement that you teach North Carolina history, and then you have the legislation that you allude to that requires that various principles, some of which we've talked about in the course of our remarks today, be included in I believe it's a semester-length course. I don't have a copy of it in front of me, so I'm relying on my perhaps feeble memory about that, and it lists the number of, I'd say 10 to 15 particular principles that need to be addressed. We are certainly trying to work with the Department of Public Instruction as part of this effort. Early on, the two of us went down and met with Superintendent Atkinson and a number of other representatives of the Department of Public Instruction in the State Board of Election to let them know what we were doing and to offer up our help. They gave us copies of a stack of paper that reflected various course objectives for various grade schools that I have read. Didn't really compare them to the act, so I can't comment on the extent to which they do or don't track it. But as we've gotten the Speaker's Bureau up and running, one of the things that I've done is to circle back with Superintendent Atkinson, because what we want to do is establish to get a single point of contact within the Department of Public Instruction to try to, for better or worse, sell what we've got to offer to the school systems. And I've certainly made a note of the enactment of that legislation and what it tries to cover. And as I develop my own remarks and have made a mental note that I need to try to compare what I'm saying with the list that's in the particular statute that you're talking about, so that we can help the department comply with that act. Again, it's like everything else, it's a work in progress, but one of the things that I really want to do is get the Department of Public Instruction to be one of the ways that we can get people out into the public, and because if there's anything more important than educating school children about this subject, I don't know what it is.
Yes, sir.
What curricula, materials, and resources would you recommend for public schools?
I always recommend don't read about what somebody said, read what they said. Go back to the writings of Washington and Jefferson and Hamilton, Federalist Papers, Democracy in America, but be sure you're reading what they actually said. Look at Washington's inaugural addresses. Look at his, like I mentioned, the farewell address. Read Jefferson, read Adams. Look at the debates that were occurring about, is the French Revolution going well or not? Is the should we align with England? Should we align with the French? To me, these founding principles are just so important. So I certainly highly recommend that. Now, Mr. Skyver, I'd talk to him afterwards if you want to talk to him, because he's got curriculum already.
And even more basic than the materials that Justice Newby alluded to, there's very little substitute for actually reading the documents themselves. I mean, if I was to read one or two things, I'd start out by reading the federal constitution and the state constitution. There's a lot in there that only a lawyer could love, but there's also a good bit of just basic information in there about what we consider important as a society. But I agree with Justice Newby that there is no substitute for reading the original materials. If you really want, I've just got through listening. I ride up and down the road a lot and listen to recorded books, and I've just got through listening to something called Empire of Liberty, which is a volume of the Oxford History of the United States that covers the very period that we're talking about. It starts in 1789 and runs through 1815, and talks in detail about not necessarily the drafting of the Constitution. It starts right after the ratification, and how was it implemented? What were the arguments between the Hamiltonians and the Jeffersonians in the 1790s about? It was a fascinating book. It's probably too much for any school kid to read, but it was one of the better summaries of that I've read lately. Your recollection is not faulty.
But then I had the privilege of seeing the play, the opera Hamilton,
the job and the way it's portrayed, and it gives, especially kids in New York City, evidently it's just giving them an exposure to our Constitution and to our government that they would ignore otherwise. And I wonder how you look at that and look at that as a way we could educate our kids.
I mean, I certainly, as I said, had the same experience with lots of, I was always very interested in this subject, and so it never particularly bored me. I lived it as a practical matter, but I certainly know people who had very much the same reaction you did, and it was not uncommon to have uninspiring instruction in the area. That's a real challenge, in all honesty. I mean, we live in a society where you've really got to do something to grab people and get them to pay attention. And while I haven't seen Hamilton or read the screenplay or the script or anything like that, to me, anything, as long as the presentation is not totally off kilter, that can get people interested in it is a good thing. And I hope we can get more of that.
Well, for me, it was the musical 1776. That was kind of when I was coming along. But, not everybody learns the same way. Some folks are going to pick up and read the Declaration of Independence. Some folks need to watch a movie, read a book. I just finished Shuroff's biography of George Washington, which is fabulous. You read these books. My brother-in-law, Garland Tucker, has been here with a couple of his books, High Tide of Conservatism and Certain Heroes of the Conservative Movement, little biographical sketches. History's a bunch of stories, and shame on us for making it boring, okay? So, many of us have shared the experience that you described, but I think we can do a better job with that.
Oh.
I don't, in all honesty, we will never reach where we want to get, because you would like to get to a place where every citizen in the state or the country is literate in civics to considerable depth. I mean, that if you could create an ideal world, that's what you'd have. You're never going to get that. Honestly, I would to the extent that we can reach some significant number of people in some way, and therefore improve the level of understanding compared to what it is now, that will have been an achievement of to some extent. This is not a process that's going to last 2 years and stop. This is something that we need to go on and do, because there's always going to be a need for it. You're never going to get to nirvana in this area. And so all we can do is start, and we'll find some things that work, and we'll find some things that don't work, and hopefully change what we do over time. But it's going to be an ongoing process, and it's hard. You'll never get to where you'd like to go.
I'm
proposing, if you don't.
I don't know the answer to that. I'm sure that's each class, each teacher. I'm sure, like has been talked about, there's some statewide criteria. Here's my personal goal. While I wish everybody saw the world the way I do, okay, it'd be a better place. But, my goal is to, let's talk about fundamental principles about which we all agree. But let's think about stuff. Just think about it, okay? And here's my example, okay? 1969, I'm a Boy Scout going to the Jamboree, okay? And I'm getting to fly on my first airplane flight, okay? It's over at Greensboro, Winston-Salem High Point Triad Airport, okay? And the Wright brothers moved over, so I could sit there with them, the three of us, we're ready to go. Actually, it was a... Eastern Airline jet plane, okay? And so I got on the plane, my mother, my father, my brother, none of whom had tickets, walked me onto the plane and made sure that the stewardess was going to look after me, all right? Now, the question is, what did I have in all my carry-on stuff? Did I have matches? Did I tell you I'm going to a Jamboree? Of course I had matches. I'm a Boy Scout.
Did I have a pocket knife? I had a bunch of knives. I'm going to a jamboree. I'm going to trade with people. Did I have a hatchet? Well, what am I going to use my matches for? I got to light fire, you know? So I got all this stuff. Does anybody care? Nobody cares. Individual freedom high, government power low. 9/11 happens, okay? Government power high, individual freedom low. My point is, every time the government acts, our liberties are decreased. Sometimes it is the right kind of trade-off to make, and sometimes it may not be. As we're talking about, you know, what is NSA's role with regard to our emails, our text messages, our cell, you know, yes, you know, frankly, security is very important, because frankly, if you don't have life, liberty and property do not matter to you. So I've been told. I've never been dead before, but I don't think they would be, okay? So life, government's primary function is to protect my life and then my ability to exercise my liberty. If I don't feel like I can go to Walmart at 10 o'clock at night because I'm afraid, I may have the right to go there, but my liberty interest is impaired, okay? And with property, okay, I need to have the right to buy, sell, destroy. Whatever I want to do with my stuff, it's my stuff, all right? So these are fundamental aspects of the government, and we need to ask ourselves every time we allow government power to increase, is this a good trade-off? Am I willing to give what rights I had to give up for the security or for whatever the good measure that occurs? Just ask the question. Just debate it in your mind. That, for me, is my goal. I want people asking the hard questions.
You and Bob are doing good work with the civics, but from nationally, is there an effort by the Department of Education to have civics taught?
No.
Well, what I'm saying is, it seems...
Who asked the question about federalism? Did somebody just say national? I'm sorry. Well, you know, we just had a judicial conference up in Asheville. We had justices from all over the Southeast, as well as federal judges, and we gave them all of our material, and there was a presentation there about encouraging civic education. So judges get it, okay? Not everyone has the initiative that Chief Justice Martin has begun, but, you know, hopefully there is a movement afoot to encourage this nationwide. I know there was a question. Yes, sir.
Yes, the last few years, I noticed articles popping up on nullification. Are there any grounds at all constitutionally on nullification?
I'm sorry, I'm...
Nullification. He wants to know about nullification. That's why I handed the microphone to you.
I live in San Francisco, you get to do it.
The answer is there any particular any requirement that there be education about it? Don't know, to be honest with you. But, I mean, I would agree to go back to something Justice Newby said. I said he and I don't agree on everything. It would be a dull world if it did. The important thing, though, is, well, you know, if everybody was as wise as me, we'd all be wiser, I guess. But that's an example of the kind of thing that I think Justice Newby was talking about, and I would echo his sentiment that the important thing is to be able to discuss things intelligently. There have been certainly people that have espoused nullification. There have been other people that took the position that it didn't exist. I think the prevailing sentiment in the legal community after the Civil War is that that's not accepted, but as a correct statement of what the law is. But those are the types of controversies that people do need to know about. I mean, nullification goes back to the Kentucky and Virginia resolutions in opposition to the Alien and Sedition Acts, for example. You look at, there were attempts to invoke nullification. The only reason I remember this is because of the book I just got through reading, with the New England states during the War of 1812 and in opposition to the embargo. It's one thing to teach people what the rules are, but it's also important to teach people how we got to where we are now. And so there are a host of issues that have been debated over the course of the history of the country and to a greater or lesser extent resolved, but it's important to know what those controversies were, what the different sides were, and why the discussions came out the way they did, because in a democracy, nothing is ever really settled. You can revisit it anytime the governmental structure will allow you to do that.
So in the Federalist Papers, Hamilton talked about that the legislative branch has power because they've got the power of the purse. The executive branch has power because it controls the military. He argued that the only power that the judicial branch has is the power of persuasion. And as we look across our nation and we see people questioning our judicial system, questioning the rule of law, I think that certainly our goal is to help people appreciate. We understand we're not perfect. I mean, just look at our history. I mean, it's clear we're not. But on the other hand, we are a people who desire to do justice for everyone. And, if people can have confidence in the judicial branch that we are striving to be, as Lady Justice is, blindfolded, can't see who comes before, richest, poor, you know, powerful, least powerful, everybody is treated the same. That is just so vital. One of the things I think that people don't appreciate, we have judges from all over the world that come to America and North Carolina wanting to know about how we have achieved, in their minds, the rule of law. Only 10% of the world have jury trials, 90% have judge trials. Guess where the corruption is? It's in that 90%. And so we're able to use our history, and again, not perfect, but striving for justice. And Chief Justice Martin has a commission. One of his first acts as Chief Justice was to establish this commission on the administration of law and justice to seek ways that we can better ensure that there is justice for all.